to pay the full salary for the two of us. So it's just not viable, even though it was profitable. And not only that, you realize that, hey, there are some designs that just don't fly. And that becomes an inventory cost. So I'm not sure if anyone have any e-commerce. You know, you have to pack, you have to send parcels. Anyone? No? The first time you do it, you might enjoy it. If you have to do it 1,000 times, you might be cursing yourself. What the hell? Yeah. So these are the things that we learned from this. Right, and then after graduation, I started
our normal working life. And in 2014, as I mentioned, I had that idea because of my girlfriend. And that was the deadline of Ideas Inc. again. That was in 2014. So I was telling Robbie, hey Robbie, I got this idea, and there's this business competition again. Shall we join? Robbie said, okay, look. Yeah. So within 2 hours, I did an executive summary. I submitted the business plan. We got accepted. So that was the very, very beginning, how it all started for Airfrov. Yep, so the good thing is through this Ideas Inc., which is kind of like an accelerator program, we were being conducted workshops. There are speakers like Michael? Yeah, Michael was one of the speakers last time. So they will come over and share about startups, raising funds, business model validation, and so on. And this is the very first thing that we did, which I think until now is ingrained into Airfrov, and that's why we are sharing this with you as well. It is so important to get out of the building, to talk to users, to your potential customers. And that's the very first workshop. So we use a model called the Javelin Canvas. If you're interested, you can Google that. So basically, you need to validate the core assumptions of your target customers and their pain points and your solution. So for Airfrov, there are three core assumptions. Number one is, requesters, people who want to buy overseas products, are they willing to pay a stranger to bring it back? Number two, which is the supply side, the travelers, are they willing to exchange their efforts and their extra capacity in their luggage for money? Right? If any of these fail, the whole business fail. So that's how we started. So we went to Orchard Road. I engaged with probably 20, but that was the, we have a deadline for that workshop. So we did 20 packs that we spoke to. Of course, some rejected us, some don't even want to talk to us. But we actually got 10 emails. And out of these 10 emails, 5 of them actually say that existingly, they are already using other services. So this immediately opens up our mind. It shows that, hey, there's existing markets. It has been validated. These people are using other platforms to solve their needs. So that was the very fundamental point. It gives us the confidence that, hey, this is something that we really can work on. So this is how the startup evolved from just an ideation stage to a validated stage. And I believe this kind of method works even if you're launching a new feature within your company. So just wondering, who are our product managers? Yeah, that's good. So I'm sure that you will have a lot of cross-department debate on, hey, is this product necessary for our customers? Is this product going to value add our customers? Even now, today, in Airfrov, that's what we are doing every day. The good thing is every day we have customers coming to our office to collect their products. So every day we got a chance to talk to our customers. So this is the very fundamental. Get out of the building, talk to customers, validate your assumptions. Number one. Yeah. And as mentioned, so that time we were both working full time. So just like anyone who's working full time, we will say, hey, you know, yes, we have validated. There's really a market for this. But, you know, after work, I want to play a bit of Dota. Yeah, so weekends, I need to spend time with my girlfriend. So how can we work on this? Right, so that's the usual excuse that everyone gives. So even if you're working right now, if you want to launch a new feature, your engineers will be telling you this. Hey, boss, no, we have all these backlogs that we need to do. Right? If you look at it, all these are just excuses, are just reasons we give ourselves for not doing the right thing we are supposed to do. So that was us. We have zero resources, nothing. We are still in the business competition. A series of workshops about 6 months long, nothing. And this is the mistakes that we feel that we have made. We were hesitant. We were apprehensive of getting customers. Right? Actually, we don't even need a product to get customers. So that's what I learned later on. Yep. I'm sure most of you heard of this. Right? So we complain, we don't have money, we don't have the... Robbie is the tech co-founder, but he needs time to build a product. But in actual fact, there's so much resources right now out there that you can build a landing page. Or when we were reaching our demo day, so that's when things get heated up. You know, we have to do a demo day for the business competition. We have to show to the judges that we have something. That's where I start hustling. That's where I go to Changi Airport every weekend with a survey form asking them, hey, do you have experience of, you know, getting products from your friends and families? So why do I go to Changi Airport? Because they are waiting for their relatives and friends. So I go to where the customers are. Or their air crew that are coming down, arrival, I will talk to them, hey, do you have experience of shopping for others or even selling on other platforms or setting up your blog shops? So that's how we continue to validate our business model, and that's where I continue to get people to sign up with no product. It was just a survey form, a landing page, an email sign up. With that, we get about 200 emails sign up. So I spend about 4 weekends doing that. So if you divide, that means 1 weekend, 50. So it's definitely possible to do that. And that gives us a very, very strong validation. But still, we have zero paying customer. So again, I want to reiterate this point. Even with no products, we can actually have customer. So as mentioned, because of the deadline, we started doing this. And that's where we realized that, hey, we really have these people who want to get, let's say, Tokyo Banana from Japan. And in my email list, I know that these are the 3 air crews that are going to Japan. So I started contacting them. I said, hey, I have 5 orders for this. Can you help to buy? Yes. And then I sell to those people in Carousel. I sell to those people in forums. Right? So that's how I got started. No product. But I start to have paying customers. But when we first started, these are the mistakes we made. We waited for 6 months before we tried to do anything to get a single paying customer. So my sharing of this is, or for all product managers right now, is get a customer, even if we got anything. Get a prototype, get them to pay. That validates and everything. And it will also throw all your assumptions out the door. Are they willing to pay for this? How much are they willing to pay for this? Yep, so this is the basic building block. So we have identified the customers. So for us, Airfrov, our customers are, we have 2 parts. The demand part are the requesters. Requesters are those who love to shop online. So what are their problems? And I would like to introduce this concept. It's called jobs to be done, right? So there's a theory by Clayton Christensen, who wrote the book Innovator's Dilemma. So jobs to be done is an interesting way of doing a user flow of how a user need to accomplish a mission, a job, for his or her daily life. So I'll talk more about that later on. So I think fundamentally is we must always relook whatever new product or new feature they were looking, as I mentioned. You don't need to have a product. You identify the customer, what are their problems, and can we get them to try it out with an MVP, with a minimum viable product? Yeah. Yeah, so this was what we did. I mean, we did the usual startup way. So we, as I mentioned, we didn't go and try to get customers. We start sketching, we understand, we did a validation of survey, we have email lists, we know who are the customers. We start sketching, and Robbie start building. But this is another mistake that we made. Yes, we start sketching based on the ideal user profile and ideal user flow. But we are not a user. So that's the most important thing. We did not get validation again from the customers. We sketch and making assumptions knowing that, hey, oh, they should be thinking this way. Oh, after they lock in, this is what they want to do. After they do this, this is what they want to do. So we design page by page based on an ideal user flow, which was pretty good in terms of our first time designing something. But as I mentioned, that's a huge mistake. And another mistake that I really want to share with you guys is, instead of doing on mobile app, you should do it on web. Because on app, you need to pay a developer, Apple developer program, that's $99. And then you need to send it for approval, that's 2 weeks. So in 2 weeks, in a 3 month startup, that's like eternity. You can't do anything, right? So the very first version, I would highly recommend everyone to do it on the web, which is what we are trying to do right now, actually. When we release new version on Airfrov, we release on the web, we test it, learn from it, and then we bring it into the mobile apps. Yep, and as I mentioned, again, all these things that we're doing doesn't give us customer. We could have been doing, as I said, the minimum matching. I will be the middleman, I will call up, I'll email the travelers, I'll say, I have this order, can you help me? Right? So for all the product managers out there, and for all the developers out there, I know that you guys hate doing work and then realizing that, hey, shit, this doesn't work. Right? So work with the business team. Understand that all these things can be validated before the developers start working. I mean, it was just me and Robbie, so we can do iteration fast. I can fight with him, he can fight with me. Things goes wrong, but eventually, the good thing is, again, we talk to customers a lot. Yep, so we reached the demo day. We won, we are the most innovative startup for that business competition, right? So that was a high, that was a career high for that at that moment of time. That was 2014. So, and I convinced Robbie to quit his job because of this, yeah. And that actually creates a whole spiral of more issues. So, you know, previously we have our salary, you know, we are just doing this on a part-time, on a weekend basis. Even if it fails, you know, who cares? Doesn't matter. Now that both of us, we quit our jobs and we decided to do this full time, things get really hitty. Suddenly you have no monthly income. Suddenly you have to pay for, again, like I said, the Apple developer program. You have to pay for hosting. You have to pay for all this. You start realizing, oh shit, $10,000, I can't do anything. Business registration is already $350. Yeah. Yeah, next. And not only that, during the business competition, there are actually three investors who pledged $100,000 to invest in Airfrov. So again, for us, first time raising funds, it was like, wow, so exciting. You know, the investor gave us a pledge saying that, hey, I have pledge, keyword pledge, $100,000 for you. Okay, then we start meeting. Investor A. So you don't have any paying customers. You have no products. How big is the market? So this is where the reality sets in. So as I mentioned again, you do not need to have a product to have customers. And I think most investors will want to see that, hey, even if you have no product, you can have customers. Right? So this was really a shot in the leg for us. We got really dejected because they pledged to invest in us. But what happened? During negotiation, during talking, during several follow-up meetings, all fail, all go down to zero. So again, we are back to zero. We have no resources. But this is where the shit gets real, and this is where you really get to know that you have to do something because you have quit your job. Right? That's the reality. Yep, so as mentioned, this is where I really start hustling really hard. Every day, well, we were working in a co-working space in Purvis Street. Every day for lunch, I have a simple metric for me. I have to convince 10 customers to sign up. How I do it? I go to Raffles City, which is right across our office. during lunch, I would look at the office ladies who are going to Kate Spade, Coach, perfume stores there, and I'll say, hey, do you know that this product's actually cheaper in US and I can actually get it for you? Yep, 10 a day. So Robbie is the one that's more shy, so he would just stand aside and watch me do it. Yeah. And I ride bike usually, but during that period of time, so I actually realized that, hey, in MRTs, I can also talk to ladies. Yeah. So, okay, the good thing is I have a thick skin. I think that's very important for me. Yeah, because you get rejected. You get rejected all the time. But it's also beautiful and very satisfying to actually see people, wow, this is amazing. They look at your product and they tell you, wow, I have never thought that this is possible. And they sign up as a user. And they start posting. 10 a day, that means 100 a week. More than 100 a week. Right? I mean, you'll get more than 10 sometimes. Sometimes, yeah. And that means I'm growing 100% week on week because I started with 200 users only. Right, so every week I'm growing. So that's a very simple thing that we were doing. We tried to get hustle. Every day I go hardware zone and I saw, hey, this guy is going to Japan. Okay, can you help me buy this from Japan? Oh, hey, this guy wants to buy Japan stuff. Hey, I'm going to Japan. I can help you buy this. Again, I have no product. Robbie was still building the product at that point of time. So this is what we call the minimum viable product, concierge service. So think of how you can do it for your own company, for your own idea that you're doing. Do that. That's the very, very basic validation stage. And from there, you also learn the whole process of what are the requirements the users have? What are the requirements the supply side have? So for example, just to share, what we learned from this, very simple, is that the supplier, the travelers, imagine you're an air crew, you just fly to Germany and you came back. Would you want to meet up users? Let's say if you have 10 orders, would you? You're probably too tired to do it, right? So that's why the last mile logistic was so important. So that's why we integrated with our last mile partner. We also use our office as a collection center. So all they have to do is they just dump everything at our office. Right, so these are the learnings that we learn from all this minimum concierge service that I provide. They tell us that, hey, can I just drop it off? You know, I don't want to, it's too heavy for me to carry this. Things like that. From all this, we learn and we improve. Yep, so summary. So as I mentioned, the most difficult part is really from the zero. Zero number of users, you have no resources, you have no products. But please keep in mind that that's not an excuse for getting a paying customer. Right? You don't need a product to get a paying customer. I know this is a product camp. Yeah. But you don't need a product to get a paying customer. That's not key number one. Number two is, once you have something, because from that number one, you keep learning. You learn the requirements, you learn what is the expectation from the users, and then you start building. And when you build, like what I said, we make assumptions. We did not validate that. So example, just to give one example, in the very first beginning of our app, when a user posts up a request, we actually require them to pay the money first. So let's say I want to buy the latest Nike shoes from US. I post up $250, the user have to pay first. So we make the assumption that, hey, since this user really want this badly, he will pay it first. But no, definitely. No one will pay for that money when he or she don't even know how he's going to get the product. Right? So that's one assumption that we made wrongly. But we learn from it. So we adjusted the flow, we make sure that the user can post for free only after a traveler offer, then the user have to pay. So there are a lot of other considerations in between, like PayPal fees. We were using PayPal at that time, which is crazy expensive. Luckily, we got into the PayPal Blueprint program. So there are things like this which, if I could turn back time, I would have validated my customers first. Yeah. So this is really the key point of my keynote speech. Validate with your customers first. Yeah. And as I said, you don't need money to get customers. As I said, take MRTs. During lunch, go to auto shops. Depending on your product, you should be near where your customers are. Talk to them. Yep. So back to about drawing the user flow. So this is something that we just implemented recently in Airfrov, and I think it's very important to share it with you guys as well. So it's started by Clayton. So he did a research with McDonald's. McDonald's actually found out that for their milkshakes, the highest sales is in the morning, early mornings, 6 to 7 o'clock. Anyone make a guess? Why is that so? Yeah, exactly. So 80% of the sales are to drivers. Why? Because in US, they have to drive at least 1 hour to reach their workplace. And because of that, they need something to fulfill their hunger, to satisfy their hunger. And if they were to buy coffee, it's too hot. It's too difficult to drink and drive with one hand, right? If they were to buy a bagel, a sandwich, it's too difficult again to eat with one hand while driving. If they were to eat a banana, you finish it within 10 minutes and you'll be hungry for the rest of your ride. So they found out that milkshake presents the best solution for their job. While driving, the drivers need something to fulfill their hunger, fulfill their thirst, and it must be easy for them to hold, must be easy for them to consume. Right, so that is how we call the jobs to be done. Milkshake is fulfilling the job of these drivers to satisfy their hunger. And because of that, they improve the product. For example, even if you were to upsize your milkshake, the milkshake bottle won't be too big so that it will forever be able to put inside the cup holder, even if it's the largest size. That's one. Number two, they actually created an express queue for drivers because they know that these drivers are in a rush for time. So through this design research process, we realized that, hey, same for Airfrov, we realized that, hey, users want to get products from overseas. That's the job. But what are the problems that they face functionally and emotionally? So functionally, for example, if they were to ship it, let's say, using VPOS, anyone for VPOS? No one? Okay. So if they were to ship it using VPOS, yes, I mean, sometimes they can get it really cheap, but there's this question mark. How much does it cost? What is the volumetric weight? You know, we have customers shipping a toy like this. It costs twice the cost of the toy. So it doesn't make sense at all to ship. So there's this emotional aspect as well. There's this uncertainty. And functionally wise, the customer have no trust in terms of how much he or she is paying. So for Airfrov, we solve this problem because you can engage directly with the traveler. The traveler make a price and the price is fixed. You know, there won't be any surprises down the road. And emotionally, okay, wrong spelling. That's not mine. I downloaded this picture. Yeah. Yeah. So emotionally, using Airfrov, they get different sense because they are talking to a traveler. It's a one-to-one relationship. You're not, if you use VPOS ever, if you email in and you say, "Hi, dear customer, thank you for your email. We'll get back to you in 3 to 5 working days." That's what you are facing if you're using a corporate service, a forwarding service. On Airfrov, because their supplier is a traveler like them. These travelers are like personal shoppers. So they will actually provide extra service. They will say, "Hey, maybe this product is not so nice. I'm actually at a store now." They will take some pictures and they will say, "Hey, there are actually other colors or other designs. Would you like them?" So this type of personal service provides an additional emotional benefit to our customers, right? So these are things that we learn as we grow. We didn't know that. We didn't know that Airfrov is providing this type of emotional benefit to our users. But back to you, if you're doing your products, you should think of it as this. You should think of both the functional and the emotion. Are we solving the problems, the jobs? Are we making their life easier? Are we also creating emotional high to them? What are their emotional needs as well? So that's very important. And that's something that we learn through our growing journey. Yeah. Yeah, so we launched, we have products. So that was from 0 to 1. So when in the first 6 months, we were unfortunately not very data-driven. So I'm setting the stage for Trade Hero later on. He will talk more about data. We have, the usual loop of the lean startup. Build, measure, and learn. So we are learning, but we are not learning on a quantitative level. We are learning based on our human interaction, our conversation with the customers. But we do not know exactly in between what happened. So this is where, for any product manager, for any developers, for any business guy, it's very important that right in the beginning, you guys have a very clear hypothesis, a very clear metric that you want to measure. We didn't have that. That's the mistakes we make. So I admit that, but we learn. We learn from it. So if you are just a startup, you know, startups. No, you're not. Yeah, so startups, I mean, when you first started, you have no resources, right? But a lot of analytic tools are actually free. Mixpanel is free for the first 100,000 points. You have heat analytics. You have a lot of heat map. You have even Inspectlet. You can actually watch a video of how the user actually interacted with your website and so on. So you make sure you set in all these analytics and learn from it. But of course, you must have a very key metric that you know that you're measuring. For example, in Airfrov right now, we are measuring, one of the key metrics we are measuring is how fast users get their product. Right? So I'm proud to say that right now, when we first started, because the network effect is not strong, people takes maybe 14 to 21 days. Now it's actually less than 7 days. Yep. So these are the metrics that you must have in mind. You define what is success looking like. You draw the line, say, hey, if this is not working, that means something is wrong. What are we going to do? So for those who are interested to find out more about this, I would recommend you to read the book called Lean Analytics. Very simple, but very applicable. Yeah. And not only that, Not only that, the second mistake that we made is because, you know, as what Mark Zuckerberg said, we love to break things fast. So we also love to come up with new features fast, but we did not plan for the future. At the point of time, in the first 6 months. And this is where we make a lot of mistakes that are still very costly due today. For example, our travelers, our supply side, can actually post recommendation. They can post, hey, I've seen these Korean shoes that's very nice in Korea, right? You can buy it at this price. So it's a separate function from what the requesters can do. But because of that, when we designed the data structure, we did not plan, hey, what happens if this recommendation grows to 10,000? What happens when it grows to 100,000? Right. So when you're building features, yes, you want to build it fast, you want to measure the success, you should also think, what's going to happen? What's going to happen if I were to scale this to another country? My data structure, my architecture, how is it going to look like? Right. So these are mistakes that we make, and we are still paying for it right now. And I hope that you guys don't make the same mistakes. It's okay to do testing fast, but ask yourself, what's next after I build this? What if I scale this to 100 times? What's going to happen? Yeah. 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 So as mentioned, okay, it's still the two of us, and then slowly we get a bit of funding, we get more developers, but there are still too many things to build. I'm not sure. Okay, now we use Trello. So basically the cards on things to do are never ending. It's never ending. You move here, you move there, then you get more things coming up. Yeah, so product manager, do you feel so? Yeah, so unfortunately this is the reality. And I think this is something that we need to learn really from Apple. You know, for every yes, they say 1,000 no. So this is also what we did in Airfrov. At the very beginning, when we have some users, I sit down with Robbie and say, hey, there are some things that we really can't do. We don't have the resources. We have just me and you. We have an offshore developer. We need to learn to say no. And these are the three no's that we say. So, for example, no selling, demand driven. So this also creates our branding strategy. We know that technically and branding and marketing wise, this is our positioning. This is our mind share. If you want to get overseas products, this is what you do. So number two, we have less than 100K funding when we first started. How can we invest in any, as mentioned, we need last mile logistics, right? We can't, we don't have the money. So no investment in debts, very clear from day one, but we partner. And number three, as a peer-to-peer platform, trust is the most important thing. So again, because of this, no counterfeit goods, and this rule that we set right in the beginning, we have made a lot of good decisions from there. I mean, ultimately, we want to make money, and we make money for every transactions that go through, right? So we have people bring back fake products. If we allow that fake products to go through, we make money, right? But that is only in the short run. So we say no. We say, hey, sorry, we don't allow this. I'm going to bring down your listing because your product's fake. Very simple. A simple decision made at the beginning shaped all the decisions in terms of branding and products in the future. Right. So look at your own strengths and competencies on what are the things that you're going to say no to, and that will help you to differentiate yourself from others. Yeah, so now that we have more developers, we have paying customers, we have users, we have data, we know what are the things we need to build. And then, this is where, again, it's never ending. And there's always fighting. And as the business person, I would say, no, why can't you do this in a week? So I'm a non-tech person. You know, the technical guys or developers say, no, there's no way we can do this in a week. So of course, I'm learning as we grow. And this is a very simple way for you to prioritize, and I learned this from ProductCamp as well. Product Lab, I think, this company. Yeah. So just, if you look at a feature list, for example, at the very beginning, we have this feature set, we don't even have search. We have payment, we only have PayPal. Logistics, as I said, nothing yet at the point of time. So what should we do next? What's our plan for the next month? So we will rank them accordingly on the user's value. How much is this feature going to help the user experience? How much is it going to help growth? And how much is it going to generate revenue for us? And how complex that is. Sometimes the most complex stuff doesn't bring you any value. So why work on it? Right. For example, after doing this exercise, we realized that, hey, the currency converter is a good to have. You know, sometimes during negotiation, the travelers and the requesters, they will negotiate on the currency. But even without a built-in calculator, they can do it on other apps. So it's not a must-have. So we break down this into must-have, good-to-have, and nice-to-have, the usual path, and then we focus on the must-have, which are core to the usability. Yeah, so that's how we prioritize. But there are actually a lot of prioritization techniques which you can learn more if you just Google Product Lab. For example, affinity mapping, user stories, and buying feature. Buying feature is actually very interesting for those who already have a product. So let's say if you are creating a new service, are users willing to pay for that? So that's a very simple test. Yep. And as you grow, as the team grows, I think the very key learnings that I have from working with different developers, from the marketeers, is you must do this with all the stakeholders. So the marketeers, they won't feel happy if they're marketing a product that they don't trust, they don't like, they feel it sucks. Marketeers? No? No marketeers? Right? So if you're in the process of building that product, you'll feel different. You'll feel that this is something that I am confident of selling. I know that these are what my customers want. For the developers, same thing. Sometimes they will question themselves, is this worth building? Right. So as the product manager, you have to convince them, bring them in, show them the data, let them know that these are users' problems, these are the users' value that we will generate, and these are the business goals that we have. Yeah, so every day we are prioritizing, and even for today, just because I know that I'm coming, so for today, we prioritize a feature to be launched in 3 days. Yeah. And as the team grows, which Agony will share as well, you have people from all sorts of life. Right? So this I'm setting the stage for the speakers later on. You realize that everyone have different expectations, everyone work differently. Right? And because we have investors as well. Investors are one of your stakeholders. Investors also want to see what's your product roadmap. So culture, eat strategy for breakfast. And why is that so? I'd like to share. It's because with the right cultural values, it affects the decision making of everyone, all the stakeholders, the marketeers, the product owners, the developers, even the customer support. One example. So as I mentioned just now, right, no fake products. So if our customer support receive a complaint about a fake product, we will take action immediately. So the decision making become very fast. Yes, we are making money on this, but no, we shouldn't be doing the wrong thing. And this translates to performance. The customers are happy. The team members know exactly what to do on an everyday basis. And recently, in order to inculcate this kind of cultural values to our team, we actually did a in-house study on what is Airfrov culture. Yeah, next one. Yeah, so I'm very happy to see this actually. So I talk about managing products, but ultimately it's actually your team. As the product manager, it is your team that's making things possible. Right? And it is how you set the cultural values, how you treat your people, how you treat your product developers, how you treat your product marketers. And that will affect how your product will look like. So ultimately, that's the final core base of any product manager, which Evgeny definitely will share about that. Yeah, so I'm very proud to say that even though we are a small company, these interns, our full-timers, give me this type of feedback. Yeah, and that affects whatever work they are doing on the product. Yeah. Yeah, so as mentioned, we are doing a quick iteration right now. I hope to get your feedback. I'm doing quick customer validation now. We are launching a new feature. It's group buying, just testing it out. If you download the app, you can order it on the latest Google Pixel phone. It's cheaper from Lazada and anywhere else. Yeah? And use my code. You see, I'm hustling. I'm getting customers. Yeah, so use my code to get $10 off.
Okay, I just want to check. Something like electronics, they usually carry a warranty. How do you necessarily deal with that?
Yep, so fortunately for Google Pixel, the warranty is kind of international, but in the event that you really spy, you can write us a ticket. We will try to get it sent back to Australia. We are getting this from Australia.
Okay, and then the cost too incurs the cost of taking it back and forth?
Depends, but we have to look at case by case, but if it's really a lemon, we'll do it for you, for free.
Cool.
Yep. Hey. Yes, so this includes taxation already. Yes. So a little bit of secret, because in Australia, if you were to buy above a certain amount, you get tax refund. That's how we get the cost low. We get a tax refund from Australia, even though we have to pay tax in Singapore, our cost is already lower. Yeah. All right, next slide.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Back to taxation. But because you're bringing products to be sold by other people, you have to pay inverse taxes. The shoppers have to buy import taxes when they land in Singapore. How do you convince them to do this? It's not like very fun to do.
Yeah, so unfortunately, we can't enforce on that tax, but we do educate them. And I have been invited to customs 3 times for coffee. So it's something we know. For this case, it's definitely, because it's conducted by us, we have all the proper procedures. But in terms of our normal marketplace, I can't control. But we do spend effort in terms of educating the travelers. Yep.
But you know that you need girls, you can can do it yourself. If you have to access it from a traveler, you can go to customs and pay it yourself as a company. Like you say, like, yeah, import this, my product, we can pay it. Are you doing this?
No, 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 because we don't handle this. Sorry?
Well, why are you not doing this? I mean, if you don't have an import tax receipt from your shoppers, you can go to customer and like voluntarily pay taxes.
Very good question. So, but you must also understand that some travelers, they don't bring it back personally as well. Or some actually products that are available in Singapore, unfortunately. Or sometimes they do by shipping. When you send a product in by shipping, there's actually no tax if it's below 400. So there's so many variables, so we can't control all this. But good question, good question. Yeah, next slide. Oh yeah. So, I mean, I've been using a lot of codes, so I hope that you can remember this code, which is last time I paise to ask my friends. Now I have rough. Yeah. And for those who are new to product management, I think these are the books that you really need to read. It will help a lot. Yep, questions?
All right, thank you, Cai Li, for that. We will open the floor to questions now for Cai Li. We have a couple of people roaming around with microphones, so just put up your hand. And when you're asking your question, just tell us your name, what you do, and your question. So.
Afghani, what do you have to ask?
Hello. I'm a product manager at TradeGecko, and I really want to ask a question about jobs to be done. So it's a fundamentally reactive framework. It helps the companies and the product people to explore the existing needs of existing jobs.
Yeah.
But the truth is, technology evolves, and the way we interact with technology evolves as well. So how do you, as a company and as a product team, anticipate the needs and the jobs that are yet to appear?
Very good question. I love that. And this is something we're also trying to distill. I'll give Amazon as an example. So Jeff Bezos, on the very first day of Amazon, he made it very clear to everyone in Amazon and to the investors, to the public. Amazon is an everyday store. We have the cheapest price. That's the two core value proposition, right? So the jobs to be done that they're solving for customers are selection, price. Same for Airfrov. We know very clearly because of these jobs to be done, we know that why our users are using Airfrov is also boiled down to three core distinct value proposition and values, which is number one is trust, as mentioned. Because we, as the middleman, we hold the money. So we hold the trust. No matter what kind of businesses this, and no matter how the customers evolve, this is the fundamental need of a customer. Trust, number one. Number two is fulfillment. I mean, our customers are crazy. You know, we have people posting up jobs on catching a Pokemon in Australia. Yeah. He will give you his Gmail password. You have to log in, help him catch a Pokemon. Right, so fulfillment. So how are we going to do this? We got Airfrov, yeah. And this is our fundamental core strength and the fundamental need of a customer as well. They need someone to do this from overseas. Okay? And, yep.
Still doesn't answer my question.
Okay, so because we have this, we know that these are the core fundamental needs. Whatever jobs they need to do are from this fundamental needs, either trust or fulfillment. And how we are going to do that, it depends on us, as you said, the technology. And that's why we're testing that group buying. Because we are still fulfilling these two core needs, which is the trust you're getting from a trusted source, and you're able to get it within this day. That's our promise. Yeah.
Cool, thank you.
Thank you, Evgeny.
Hi, I'm Yitch. I look after UX at IBM at the moment. So my question is, how do you deal with the legal issues in terms of compliance? Especially like if you can buy certain things legally overseas, like I can get weed in Amsterdam legally, and how do you stop people from importing it?
So we have a kind of a semi-automatic filter system, but most of it, I would say, is actually depending on our community. So we have this is actually part of Apple's restriction as well. You need to have a flag button on all your listing, right? So I would say 80% of this, we know that these are illegal, it's actually because of our users. They actually flag it out for us. Just to give one example, there's a it's a rat poison, which is considered poison in Singapore, right? But it's actually legal in Thailand, in Indonesia. I can't remember the name, start with B. Bo rat or something. No, not that bo rat, sorry. Yeah, so that is, like I said, that is actually legal in these countries, but it's not legal in Singapore. We didn't know that, but our users flag it up and we bring it down immediately. Yeah, so it's kind of reactive, unfortunately, but we are hoping to build in some predictive to make it preventive. Yeah, but thank you. Good point.
Hi, that was a really nice presentation. I'm Abhishek. I'm a product developer. So I also like in the product management team. I have a question regarding the, you emphasized on the fake product, right? So how do you ensure that? Because I heard that the user have to report it, right? So the trust is already broken, right? He has got a fake product and I mean, it's not what he expected.
Yeah.
So he might be apprehensive, like, dude, I'm not going to use this platform anymore. I mean, although I reported, you know, you can't gain back that impression, right? And secondly, fake product, even if the user doesn't know, like some people use those Beats earphone, you know, and it's like damn cheap and it's fake, but you can't recognize from that, right? So how do you deal with that, even if the user doesn't know?
So if it falls through, let's say if there's really fake product being transacted, a very simple way of maintaining that trust issue is a review, which is, I mean, just like any other selling platforms or any other e-commerce platform, you get to leave a review for the travelers, right? And for the travelers, they are in this for a long haul. I mean, they are sellers, they are travelers, they are making money from this. And if they were to do something for the short-term gain, they lose their money-making opportunity. So for us, for example, we have a verification status, just like for Airbnb. We have a verified traveler, we have super traveler, which they got more benefits, they can pick up more jobs, right? Any infringements, any complaints of this, basically they lose their chance. And with that, they can't make money. And that is the biggest motivating factor for the system to make sure that the trust is there. That's a very simple way. Yeah. But yes, you're right. Some do fall through, which we have no control of. Unfortunately, we can't do anything. If we try our best to remedy, we try our best to serve these customers, but that's all we can do.
I'm Edwin. I enjoyed your talk. And from an institute at NTU, I'm also an entrepreneur. Just a question in that currently in your stage of you know, selling and growing, what are your current marketing plans to grow your platform?
Yeah, so the good thing is I have a very good marketer in the team. I treat her as a co-founder. And to be honest, I'm not a very good marketer, I'm more of a hustler. Right, I love to talk to ladies on MRT and series. So with that in mind, the very core thing that I mentioned about the differentiation, the brand, the branding is actually so important. So if you were to just Google Airfrov, you see people, even on Carousel, they'll say, hey, if you don't want this, I can Airfrov it. Yeah, so that kind of mind share is so important because it builds the brand image. When I ask you, hey, if you want to get overseas products, what do you do? I have profit. Right. So that's the most important thing. So that's the branding strategy that we took, that we position ourselves as. And in terms of marketing, we do pay channel like Facebook and all that, but we spend less than 1K a month on that. Most of it is actually organic. That means 70-80% of our new users, our whatever conversion, are actually from existing users referring their friends. So that's the call.
We have time for one more question.
Hi, Cai Li. Appreciate the presentation, it's a good one. My name is Maulana, I'm a product manager. So I came from Indonesia, come to Singapore, especially for this event, and I did use Airfrov. I decided to buy some Apple products from Singapore. Unfortunately,
your boss.
The AirPods. Unfortunately, the traveler turned me down because he didn't find it. So anyway, I realized that there's interesting that you're an early stage startup, but I do realize that when I try to use your services, the fees are already there, and it's actually quite, well, it's logical, of course, because you're selling a service. But, in early stage startups, we do see sometimes that the fees are somehow really, really cheap and somehow illogical. But do you think that by you imposing those fees right now in the early stage, does that inhibit your growth? And how much, like if my friends who are also budding entrepreneurs, they are really confused about when do I need to worry about making money? So it's like users first and then money next, and yeah, that's like the mantra of right now the startup community right now. So what are your thoughts on that? Do your fees inhibit the growth of your company?
Definitely, yes. I mean, who don't want a free service? That's for sure, right? So I think ultimately, again, it's back to your positioning and what's your growth pathway that you intend to do. If you intend to go the free model, you must find a way to monetize in future. And for that free model and monetization in the future, you must have a very clear roadmap. So what do you need in order to monetize in the future? You need, let's say, 6 million users for that. So I don't have that. So, and I know that people who are going to use Airfrov, I won't have 6 million in Singapore. Right? So I have to monetize. So you need to do your own research on what are the potential monetization strategies. If I do free, how will I monetize? Will I have a big enough market for me to monetize in other ways in the future? It's quite impossible to change from free to paying, unless you have a freemium model built in right in the beginning. Right? Whereas if you're already charging a fee, you can think of other ways to continue to monetize. But it's also very difficult to increase the price later on. And the customers will lash back at you and say, hey, I've been using your service for 2 years. How come suddenly so expensive? Right? Things like that. But yes, you're right. It does inhibit the growth because people will be thinking, hey, I could use Carousel for free, for example. Right? I can use Gumtree for free. You know, things like that. It does. Definitely it does. So it's really up to you as product manager. What's your future strategy? That's why I say you should think, what's next? If I do this, what's next? If I monetize now, what's next? Think about it. Just ask yourself, what's going to happen if my users, if my business grow 100 times? Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much, Charlie, for that.
Thank you.
Could we just request